I created an Evergreen webinar checklist to walk you through the steps to create an Evergreen webinar. This is very, very similar to the live webinar checklist that you have also in this course. I created this one in the color green so that you don't get them mixed up. It says Evergreen at the top, and again, there are some subtle differences. In the event that you have already created a live webinar and you're going to be using the live webinar recording for your Evergreen webinar, some of this will be stuff that's already done. You will have already selected a webinar topic. You will have already written the headline and the description in those cases, and you won't have to do that again. We're going to go over the checklist now as if you're just starting from scratch. You have not had a live webinar, you're going to be creating a recording from scratch, and so let's consider it that way. So again, you're going to pick a topic. That topic could be a HUD home, buying a HUD home. It could be how to stage your home. It could be, you know, how to finance your home with 203K rehab financing. It could be any topic. After you select the topic, then write a really, really good, hooky, catchy headline, something that will be engaging. Something in 140 characters or less, something that can fit within a tweet. We're not doing that at 140 characters just so that you can use it on Twitter, but because that is a good rule of thumb for a headline length that works in many, many cases. Write a description for your webinar, something that will talk about the benefits, something that will be engaging, something that will give the attendee a reason to actually be there. Then you've got a couple of dates. You want to set a couple of dates for yourself or a single date to do a couple of recordings, possibly two recordings. One is an introduction. And on the registration page, it's very common practice now for people to record a very, very brief 30-second to 60-second introduction to the webinar, an invitation in your own voice. It can be, you know, done with a webcam, you know, with, you know, webcam direct to face, or it can be done with a PowerPoint or anything else. And that's the kind of an introduction that says, you know, hi, this is Fran Torsen. I'm having a webinar. We're going to be talking about FHA 203K financing. I have my favorite lender who's going to be joining me. Sign up here, and I'll send you the information right away. And that's the kind of an introduction recording I'm talking about. Then you're going to also record a webinar. And the webinar itself, again, is going to be about 30 to 60 minutes in length. And you're going to record that. So you're actually going to be creating a recording that will be converted to a webinar. After you have recorded it, check it out. See how it sounds. Make sure it works okay. Make sure that it loads very, very quickly. You know, if you're creating an Evergreen webinar, it is going to be an experience that is going to simulate a live event. So you want to be sure that your recording doesn't have a great lag time. There's a program called Handbrake that you can download for free at handbrake.com. And if you're a techie kind of person, you can use that and do some tweaking there. If you're not techie, then you know you can ask somebody who is. When you review the webinar, make some notations about time. And here's why I say that. There are going to be opportunities during the webinar for you to inject some simulated live happenings. It may be in the chat section. It may be by introducing a poll. A poll is a really, really good interactive thing. And you may be asking your people a question in a poll. You know, you may have had a live webinar that had a poll in it, and you want to give your people here in the Evergreen webinar a chance to vote. Now, will those poll results, reflect what your Evergreen webinar attendees are clicking? No, they're not. And you want to be a little bit careful about how you use polls in Evergreen webinar. I'm going to create an entire piece about that. But all you need to know right now is you need to make a notation about the time that you will be doing the poll, if in fact you're going to be doing that. And that would be when the poll would commence, that's the first time, and then when the poll would end. Okay, You may also want to make a notation about time for buttons to be appearing on the page, or for downloads, or for hyperlinks. And with some webinar platforms, there is a space below the video where you can say, okay, at precisely 20 minutes into the webinar, I want there to be a download link to something I'm talking about in the webinar, and I want that to stay on the page for 2 minutes, and you can make that happen. You can say, you may be selling something, you know, you may be selling attendance to something or something that requires a buy button, and that, you know, you have the ability to make a buy button appear, let's say, at 40 minutes into the webinar. So if there are places at points in time in the Evergreen webinar where you want to introduce a poll or a link below the video or a button or any of that kind of stuff, you know, make a note to yourself about that. When you're reviewing the webinar, make those notations about time in your checklist here, and then when you get to the point that you're setting up your webinar, it will make it much, much easier. You know, decide what days or day your webinar is going to appear. You may have an Evergreen webinar that will be appearing every Friday. Some people create webinars that appear every single day, and I think that probably is overdoing it relative to meeting somebody's expectation for a more live kind of an experience, and it becomes very, very transparent when they can attend the same webinar every single day, sometimes three times a day, that you're really just working with a video. And I think that the value and the perceived value of a webinar when it's available all the time every day is really, really significantly less than something that is not. Bear in mind too that when people are making a commitment to attend a webinar, they're making a commitment to carve away some time and devote more attention to this subject than they would to a video that's available all the time. So bear that in mind. And you may want to make it available, you know, once or twice or maybe three times a week. But anyway, you want whatever you do decide to do is your decision. And this is a good place to make that decision and write that down and make a note for yourself. Also, you know, to what time do you want that webinar to actually be available? Is that going to be in the morning or the afternoon or the evening? Is it during business hours? You know, decide what is the best time for your market to view and when you have the most registrations. What you really should do is schedule several and do them at different times and different days and test that and see where people in your market issue the best response and the most registrations. And when you have a feeling about that, then you know, stay with what works. Again, is it going to be a recurring webinar? An Evergreen webinar can certainly be a recurring webinar, and it can happen as often and frequently as you like. Again, I wouldn't suggest you do it too often. There is another argument to be made about, you know, making it available all the time. And again, there are some very, very valid arguments from both sides of the coin there. I'm not going to, you know, belabor it. My personal feeling is that you don't want to do it too often, but again, that's your choice. And the neat thing about Evergreen webinars is that is technology that gives you a choice to do things the way you like to do with it. Alright, who's the organizer and the presenter? You know, again, the organizer and presenter aren't that important here, because you're working with a recording and really working with the technology. You've got somebody who's going to be working with an administrative panel, and that's about it. So that is not a concern. Panelists really are not going to be a concern. You may want to gather panelists for the recording, to create the recording, and that's okay, but you don't have panelists on an Evergreen webinar, nor is there an opportunity to engage in a live way using voice. You want to set up a lead registration page, again. You may also want to set up a separate web form to gather registrations, and you can do that in addition to the registration page. You can set up a web form and put that on your on your website. You can share that on Facebook. You can share that on Twitter. You can invite people to sign up just with a simple web form and not necessarily with a page. You may also want to have a registration survey on the page connected to that. That is something you can do. And create a thank you page. Once a person has registered, send them to a thank you page and say, thanks for registering, here's the information. And then, of course, they will get an email reminding them and telling them to mark their calendar. In most cases, you can incorporate a calendar marking function right into the thank you page, and there can be a link there that says, in many cases, you know, add this to your Outlook calendar, add this to your Google calendar, and for whatever calendar type of function you have. You also want to set up webinar alerts, again, just like you would for a live webinar, and use email, use SMS technology, you know, text and voicemail, and that's very, very important. Create the presentation. Yeah, I mean, certainly if you're going to be creating a video, you'll be doing that with some kind of presentation, so that stays on the list. You also want to probably think about handouts and creating some handouts for your folks so that they have something that they can walk away from the table with. Remember, if you're creating handouts, whether they're in Word or PDF, you know, make sure that your contact information is on there. Make sure there's a clickable link so they can find your website. Don't just give them a handout that doesn't have a way for them to get in touch with you. Same thing with bonuses. You know, a bonus can be something that will incentivize somebody to share your registration. Again, create the poll questions. You may or may not want to use a poll question. You may or may not be okay with that. Again, I'm going to create a separate video that talks about using poll questions in an Evergreen webinar, because there are some ethical questions about using that and how to use it. That is an interactive device that can be used to manipulate and skew results in somebody's favor. That's not an ethical way of doing it, but there are ethical ways of doing polls within an Evergreen webinar, and I'll address that in a separate video. Question management and engagement. Now remember, this is not live, but there is room for engagement, and engagement does happen. Frequently, there is a chat, a live chat, and you may tie that live chat to an email. I have had live engagement with numerous people attending my Evergreen webinars who engaged using the chat function. And what happens is they're, you know, and mostly this has been happened on my copyright webinar. I get the most engagement there. And I'll give you an example of a piece of engagement on the copyright webinar. One day I was sitting and I got an email that came from the chat from a woman who was attending my copyright webinar, and she said she was a writer, she's a real estate reporter, and she was having a great deal of difficulty because there were real estate agents who were swiping her articles, copying her articles into their blogs, and she was very, very frustrated. And so she commenced a chat correspondence with me, and the chat happened, you know, on her screen. It sent me an email, and then she and I went back and forth using email, and talked about that, talked about her dilemma, and we, you know, ultimately connected by telephone after the webinar was over. So, you know, there is engagement possibility. There are engagement possibilities using an Evergreen webinar. Did I know that she was going to be there at that moment? No, I didn't. But I happened to be on my computer a lot. If I wasn't on my computer, for instance, when this woman engaged, I would still have received an email. I doubt that she would have had an expectation of hearing from me right away, because I was, you know, probably in her mind, I was conducting the webinar. I don't know that she knew that it was a recording. You know, we didn't talk about that. She liked the webinar, and she did tell me that. So you know, it's a neat way to be in touch with people, to have engagement, to seed engagement, to seed discussion, and connect with your target market. You can do some really, really neat stuff with public relations and advertising. You can advertise these webinars. You can put, you know, create events on your Facebook fan page, create events in LinkedIn and elsewhere. Because when people, you know, are invited to see your webinar, they may see the opportunity to attend, you know, at more than one occasion, and that just stays live, and you can just keep it out there. Always a good idea to practice this stuff anyway. You know, check your recording plans. Evaluate, take a look. You know, look at it with an objective eye. Ask people what they think. Strive to be better. You know, talk about some best practices. Mix it up and have a discussion with people who are also creating live webinars or evergreen webinars. Ask them what they think about it, how you can improve it. You know, the first one's not going to be the best. The first one is going to be possibly awful. You need to get through it. So get through the first one. You know, go get through the first one before you actually create something that people are going to attend. You know, don't create your first evergreen webinar and put it out there unless it's really, really good. It's really unlikely. I have never met anybody who ever did it the first time and had something that they were happy enough about that they were ready to just release it and publish it for the general public. So go through a practice session, by all means. Create a practice webinar, a practice evergreen webinar. When you have it and it's live, you know, you can do tracking just like you can with a live webinar. You can see who registered to attend, who did not attend when they were going to. If they don't attend at the appointed hour, they will get an email that says, you know, sorry you couldn't make it, here's the replay. And then you have a replay decision. You know, do you want to make that, keep that up there so that they can listen anytime, or do you want to make that a limited window? Do you want to restrict the length of time that somebody can review the replay? I think that's a good idea, because I think you add a little bit of scarcity and urgency to the matter, and that will make people more likely to watch it sooner than later if they think that the opportunity to watch that is only going to be for a short time. Follow up with email. Follow up with voicemail. Follow up, follow up, follow up. Engage, and at some point in time, you know, you're going to take this and take it to a conversion point, where you are going to go move from from prospect to customer to somebody who's actually working with you in a transactional relationship and doing business with you, and that's the bottom line.